Good morning, Riverside. We're going to get into the Word. If you have your Bibles, please turn to Philippians 3:10. And I'm going to talk today about the power of the resurrection. Philippians 3:10, I want to know Christ, and yes, to know the power of His resurrection and participate in His suffering, becoming like Him in death, or somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Let's pray. Father, we just come to You. We thank You for Your goodness and Your love and Your mercy. And as we come into Your Word, God, let it come alive to us, plant it in our heart. And as we leave this building, God, that we know that the enemy cannot steal it because it's on firmly planted ground. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, 1 week ago, we celebrated Palm Sunday, Jesus' triumphant entry to Jerusalem. He came into town with the adoration of everyone who saw them, and their cries rang out as He rode past the crowd, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is He who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." These are the cries that Jesus heard as He entered Jerusalem, and what a difference a week makes. Jesus went from triumph to devastation, or so it seemed. He was proclaimed the King of Israel, and with a week later, He was betrayed, ridiculed, and crucified. And what strikes me is profound is that Jesus knew His destiny when He entered Jerusalem. He had the vision of what was to come, and He spoke so eloquently in John chapter 12, verse 22 through 36. And Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it only remains a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant will also be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled. What shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify Your name." Then a voice from heaven said, "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." And the crowd that was there heard it and heard it thundered, and others said an angel had spoken to him. And Jesus said, "The voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of the world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from this earth, will draw all people to myself." And He said this to show the kind of death that He was going to die. The crowd spoke up, and we heard from the law that the Messiah will remain forever. So how can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? And Jesus looked at them and told them, "You are going to have the light just a little while longer. Walk while you have that light before darkness overtakes you. And whoever walks in the dark does not know where they're going. Believe in the light while you have the light, so that you may be children of light." And when He had finished speaking, Jesus left, and He hid Himself from them. Jesus knew His destiny when He rode in on a donkey on Palm Sunday, but yet He came anyway. He knew that the reason He was on earth was for this very hour. He had the vision of the power of His resurrection. He knew He would have to die in order to be resurrected, yet Jesus came anyway. He knew He would be betrayed, but He came anyway. Because He knew that God had spoken to Him and that was His destiny, His sufferings happened way before the cross. And it was in the Garden of Gethsemane where His submission to God, where He actually laid down His life in prayer so that He could complete the mission that was before Him. The scripture that we read earlier in Philippians, it says, "And I want to know Christ." Well, that's my prayer today. I want to know Christ. I want to know the power of the resurrection in my life every single day. You know, when you come to the Lord, sometimes, you know, you come to the Lord and God, you have a great transformation. And you look different, and things are different in your life, and things are different in your heart. And then when you've been a Christian for a little while, it seems like sometimes people settle back into the way they were before, and everything is just status quo. Well, I'm here to tell you this afternoon that nothing should be status quo in our life. That if we have the power of the resurrection on the inside of us every single day, we should see the manifestation of the Holy Spirit in our lives and see God at work. So I ask you, is the power of the resurrection living on the inside of you? I hope it's yes. I want to know Christ. I want to know Him more. I want to be hungry for the things of God. I want to be hungry for the Word of God. I want to see people get saved and healed and delivered in the name of Jesus. That is what it means to walk in the power of the resurrection. Amen? You know, sometimes we have sorrows, and sometimes we have griefs, and sometimes we have things that happen in our life that are way beyond our control. And sorrow and grief can come on suddenly, and before you know it, events can turn quickly, and the next thing you know, you are punched in the gut with heartbreaking news. Have you been there before? I have. And sometimes when we're faced with the grief and sorrow, our first reaction is to retreat and isolate ourselves, but let me tell you, that's the worst thing you can do. We can be caught off guard with sorrow or surprise, but you know what? We shouldn't be. John 16:33, it says, "Here on earth you'll have many trials and sorrows." But Jesus says, "But cheer up, for I have overcome the world." And whatever sorrow, whatever grief that you are going through, I say to you today to cheer up, because the same Christ that lives on the inside of you has overcome every sorrow, every grief, and has overcome the world. If Jesus has overcome the world, then that means we have overcome the world. Can you say amen? So living in this world, we know that we're going to have sorrows. We know that we're going to have trials. We know that there is going to be grief. But we also have hope. Romans 5:5, it says, "Hope will never disappoint us, because God has poured out His love to fill our hearts." And I know that whatever we might be going through, there is hope in God that never disappoints. I love knowing that no matter what I'm going through, God will never leave me or forsake me. God has my back. Look at your neighbor and say, "God has my back." John 10:10 says, "The thief comes only but to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus has come to give us life and life more abundantly." And so we can see the events that have been led up to the crucifixion of Christ. We see Palm Sunday, and now we're in Holy Week, and we know that there was the Last Supper, and then we know that there was that the Romans came and took Jesus away, and then He had a trial, and then there was Good Friday where they took Him to the cross. These events are real events. This is not just a day in Christianity that we celebrate to make ourselves feel good. This is the day that we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and King. This is the day that we celebrate that we go to the tomb and it's empty. This is the day that we know that our God is alive and He is not dead. Hallelujah. So that's what Resurrection Sunday is all about, celebrating the resurrection of our Lord. But it's also to focus on ourselves and get ourselves resurrected so that we are doing what God has called us to do. Amen. It's not just about going to work Monday through Friday, trying to make it to the next week, paycheck to paycheck, hoping that things will be okay. God has a better way. And when you open the door and led by His Spirit, He will lead you and He will guide you so that you will know and see His supernatural power in your life. I want the power of the resurrection in my life, not just on Easter Sunday, but every single day. And so there was a woman, and her name was Mary, and she was from the town of Magdala. Now, this woman was messed up when she met Jesus. She had seven demons and evil spirits. She was into all kinds of things demonic. And she probably thought there was no hope for her life. She probably thought, this is the way my life is. I'm going to have to put up with these demons. I'm going to have to put up with the torment. There is no hope for me. But one day, Jesus walked into her life. Jesus changed her life and delivered her from the demons. And the Gospel of Luke says that Jesus healed her from seven demons and evil spirits, and she was radically changed. Anybody here today been radically changed by the power of the Holy Spirit? Right? That's what happens. And she followed Jesus around and was taught by Him and learned from Him. And then one day, everything changed. They were in Jerusalem, and the Romans took Jesus away, and He was sentenced to be crucified. Well, here is Mary Magdalene, and she's there at the crucifixion. She watched as the man who delivered her from the demonic torture that she faced every single day watched while he suffered, while he hung on the cross, while he died. She was there. Mary Magdalene was there when Jesus' body was taken to the sepulcher. She helped prepare his body for burial. But then when Sabbath came, she had to wait. And the grief and the pain must have been so overwhelming. How could this happen? Why did this happen? How can the one who delivered me from all the hurt and the wounds that I had in my life, how could he be crucified? God, how could you let this happen? Have you ever said that to the Lord before? And finally, Sunday came, the first day of the week, and Mary Magdalene went to the tomb, and the stone was rolled away. But instead of being glad, she was sad, because she thought somebody took his body. And she ran, and she told Simon Peter, and they came with her to the tomb. And Mary stood outside that tomb, weeping and crying, because her heart is broken, because her Lord is not there. And she looks up and she sees two angels who tell her that Jesus is alive. And suddenly she turns and she sees someone and she begins a conversation with him. And then Jesus speaks her name. And as soon as he spoke her name, she knew it was her Lord. Jesus is speaking your name today. Do you know his voice? Are you going to answer? But he's talking to you today. He's telling you that he hasn't forsaken you, that he's always been with you in your times of need, in times of sorrow, in times of grief. You weren't by yourself. He was there with you every step of the way. And you're going to have troubles. I'm not going to lie to you. You're going to have troubles. Sometimes life is hard and there's things that happen. But the wonderful thing is that when you have Jesus living on the inside of you, you have the ability and the power to overcome whatever the enemy brings against you. Amen? Mary understood pain. She lived a life of pain and grief and sorrow. Her life had been one of demonic torment. Think about it for just a moment. I'm sure depression was involved. I'm sure she wanted to kill herself many times. People who have demons have often thought about killing themselves just to end the torment and the pain. Yet Mary faced the pain of Jesus' death. And did you know she stayed with him at the cross and didn't leave his side? She faced the pain of preparing him for burial. But she didn't run away. She stayed with him and prepared him. And she was even ready to bury him, but he rose again. You see, Mary was not a person who ran away from her pain and grief. She faced it, but it hurt, but she faced it anyway. And even though there must have been just a conflict going on in her spirit, that she knows that she has to go through and take one step in front of the other in order to make it through the day, because she's just grief-stricken because her Lord, the one that delivered her, is not here. But she faced it, and it took courage for her to take those steps. And when Jesus came back to life, she was the first person that he revealed himself to. Mary experienced the power of the resurrection because she didn't run away from her pain. She faced it. Pain is hard, you know? It's something that we don't like. I don't like it. But this I do know, if you don't face it, it will always be with you. And as we look at the example of Mary, I love that she faced it. I love that she had the courage to go through with what she needed to do. I love that she honored Jesus so much that even though she was hurting inside, that she was going to do what was expected. But when she got to the tomb, the stone was rolled away. Do you know that God is still rolling stones today? Whatever that stone is in front of your tomb, in front of that's keeping you from doing what you need to do or what you want to do or what God has called you to do, God is still rolling stones. Hallelujah. And so that will not keep you from whatever it is that the Holy Spirit has for you, if you'll just face the pain, just face the heartache, just face the grief. Did you know in Isaiah it says that Jesus bore our grief and sorrows? He bore it. He bore it. That means that if he bore my grief, my sorrow, it means I don't have to bear my griefs and my sorrows, because I can give him my pain and he can take it away. Too many people are trying to make themselves feel better by numbing the pain. And I'm just going to tell you today, nothing will numb the pain. Nothing will numb the pain. You have to work through it. You have to face it. And if you're courageous enough to face the pain, like Mary was on that day, you will be set free and you will see the power of the resurrection happening on the inside of your life. Can you say amen? And so, we know that this life is difficult. We know that there are things that happen. We know that sometimes we can't control what happens to us. But I tell you what we can control. We can control how we react to the circumstances that come our way. We can walk in peace and know that God has an answer and that he has my back. Can you tell your neighbor again, God has my back? Do you believe that? Amen. And so, I don't know what you're facing today. Maybe you're going through grief and sorrow. Maybe you just haven't faced your pain. Maybe there's some things in your life that are overwhelming you and you just didn't expect it. Maybe there feels like there's just no way out and that you can't make it. Maybe you just feel like every day is just too hard. Have you ever had days like that where you had to really talk to yourself? Well, I want to tell you, one word from God can change your life. And if you allow your spirit to push through and to be hungry for the things of God, you will get your deliverance. Amen? I don't know what you face. I don't know your hearts. I don't know the private moments when no one is around, what is going through you, what is going through your mind. But I do know that there is one who is named Jesus, that he came and he bore our griefs and our sorrows. That means he took it upon himself, the pain and suffering, so that you and I could be free. I encourage you today to give Jesus your pain, to give Jesus your losses, to give Jesus your sorrows, and allow the power of the resurrection to heal all the broken pieces of your life, and allow him to roll that stone away. Amen. When we come to know Christ and the power of his resurrection, that means that we have to allow the Holy Spirit to lead us in our thoughts and words and our actions and everything that we do, so that when you look at me, you see Jesus and not me. That's submission. Things that seemed important to us suddenly become trivial, because the big picture, it means nothing. What means everything is knowing Christ and the power of his resurrection. You know, Jesus knew his faith that day, but he came anyway because of the vision, because he had the power of the resurrection. Do you have vision for yourself, for your life? Do you have vision for your week? You know, resurrection is the message of Easter, that what once was dead is now alive. And how does that message affect you? How can the power of resurrection change your life? Because everything that Jesus did on that cross, before and after, was so that you could come to the knowledge of who he is. He's our King. He's our Lord. He's our Savior. And Mary knew that. And when she went to that tomb, she was looking for his body, because she thought that it was all over. But when she didn't find his body, and she looked around and was heartbroken because she thought someone had taken him, and turns and sees, and he speaks her name, then it was just the beginning. Jesus is speaking your name today, and what you thought might be over is just the beginning. That's the power of the resurrection. So today, as we come and we celebrate and we worship, I want to close with this, 2 Peter 1:3. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who has called us by his own glory and goodness. He's given you everything so that you could live for him. What does that look like? What does that look like for you? Is it just simply surviving, just to get by, going from week to week, you know, dragging yourself here, dragging yourself here? Or do you really want to see some changes in your life so that you can be a person who can testify of the power of the resurrection just like Mary? I challenge you today. I challenge you today. Is it simply, you know, surviving, simply going back and forth to your job, school, wherever it is you go? Or do you wake up every day and say, Lord, I want you to lead me and guide me and show me what it is I need to do today? Let's stand and pray. I'm going to pray a salvation prayer. And if you've never prayed the salvation prayer, then pray it with us. But don't pray it if you don't want to mean it. Nobody's looking at you. Nobody's paying attention to you. We're all paying attention to ourselves. We're all looking at our own hearts. But if you could close your eyes and let's pray together. Father God, I'm asking you to forgive me of all my sins. Come into my heart and be my Lord and be my Savior. I denounce Satan and all his works. And Lord, I love you. Take my life and do something with it. May it bring glory to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God's a good God, right? So we're going to have time of altar, and I encourage you to come and pray. If you need prayer, Pastor Ross and myself are here, and we'll be able to pray with you. But let's come. Let's come. And let's spend some time before God. Let's allow Him to speak to us and to show us. And let's be hungry so that the power of the resurrection lives on the inside of us. Amen.
I see the old is passed away. The new has come. Now You called me from the grave by name. You called me out of all my shame.
Thank you, Father.
I see the old is passed away. The new.
Praise the Lord. People are still praying. Hallelujah.
Now
thank you, Jesus.
Resurrection power.
Hallelujah.
Living on
thank
the
you.
Inside, Jesus.